Conference and Lecture Series here, and it's every Wednesday. And this is the last of the series for this semester. And then we'll be starting up again in the spring, and it should be, it's going to be a great lineup. So I'm going to urge again, I see a lot of people plugging in, the presenters today have worked very hard, so I think they're plugging in after me. Well, thank you. Okay, every semester, we end this series with a presentation by the Sigma Kappa Delta English Honor Society students. And this is always led by our English professor, Anthony Rodriguez, and he does an amazing job, and the students always just blow me out of the water. They do such an amazing job with it. So this semester, we've got the same group, and they're going to do a presentation called Each Moment as a Masterpiece. And they're going to talk about The Unbearable Lightness of Being by Milan Kundera. So right now, what I'm going to do is introduce Professor Rodriguez, and then he will take it from there. So let's give him a warm welcome.
Good afternoon. Welcome. I'm going to say just a few words before we begin, and I want to welcome you to Oxnard College and tell you that, as you know by now, that Oxnard College is a very special place. I've been here for over 20 years, and I love Oxnard College with my heart and soul. It's a special place for students to be comfortable while they learn, to establish a solid foundation for the future. And I think one thing that we do here is we instill hope. Our students feel optimistic and bright about their futures. We try and reach deep within them and help them to retrieve the best part of their intellectual capacities and then move on and do well for themselves. But more importantly, to make a positive impact on society. So welcome to Oxnard College, a truly unique college, a very special place, and you're very fortunate to be here, and I'm very glad that you're here. Secondly, I wanted to talk to you just for a brief moment about literature and one of the many values of literature. We like to use literature as a teaching tool, as a venue, as a place where students can come to read and pick up wisdom on the move, on the fly, and then take that wisdom out into their homes, into their communities, into the state, into the nation, and do what I just said, make that positive impact. Today, Denise Magana is going to be doing just that. She's going to be dispensing copious amounts of wisdom for us. I would therefore like for you to have your ears in a special mode, in a more attentive mode. You might think you're here for a few points of extra credit or to fill a seat or to make your way to the next event in your day. I'm telling you, you're here to learn something. Whether you are aware of it or not yet, you might just pick up some serious wisdom today. Maybe you're not here by accident. Maybe your arrival is not random. And when you walk out those doors, you're going to walk out a better person, someone who is ready to use the great literature of our society to change lives for the better. I am honored to be the faculty advisor for Sigma Kappa Delta, the Gamma Epsilon chapter here at Oxnard College of the English Honor Society for two-year colleges. Such a blessing to be here. We'll have a few students who will be involved, but primarily Denise Magana is going to be presenting her paper on the Kundera novel, The Unbearable Lightness of Being. I'm excited, I'm thrilled, I'm proud, and most importantly, I'm hopeful. So now I want to introduce Denise Magana. Denise?
Thank you. My name is Denise Magana, and I would like to thank Professor Anthony Rodriguez for that brief but wonderful introduction. Today I will be representing Sigma Kappa Delta in each moment as a masterpiece. Better. Sigma Kappa Delta is the National English Honor Society. The society promotes service and scholarship through its members, fostering all aspects of English, including literature, writing, and language. The society's central purpose is to confer distinction upon students of the English language and literature in undergraduate studies. I will be presenting a personal essay based on The Unbearable Lightness of Being by Milan Kundera, published in 1984. It is a novel that takes place mainly in Prague during the 1960s and 1970s, prior to, during, and following the invasion of Czechoslovakia by the Soviet Union. Kundera focuses on the lives of four main characters: Tomas, a surgeon, Teresa, his wife, Sabina, his mistress, and Sabina's lover, Franz. The unbearable lightness of being refers to the painful truth that we as human beings live only once. We force ourselves to overanalyze the meaning of such a fate, questioning one's reason for existing. We force ourselves to be with those we do not love out of guilt, force ourselves away from those we do love out of fear, and keep those unworthy of us closest. Living without purpose is equal to not living at all. For our actions accumulate to nothing. There is no fate ahead beyond death. There is no actual purpose to living. Just a mere hope that living for something larger than oneself may allow one to be fulfilled with the miserable truth of existence. That being that life is a mere inexplicable series of circumstances and events that one cannot account for. One can simply live for the experience. But existing serves no purpose other than being. Human time does not run in a circle, it runs ahead in a straight line. That is why man cannot be happy. Happiness is the longing for repetition. Kundera focuses on two lightnesses of being, the unbearable lightness of being and the sweet lightness of being. The sweet lightness of being is the appreciation of being only once, of existing for the duration of one life and its encounters, and only that one life and its encounters. This phrase suggests that as there is an unbearable lightness to being, that which is painful, there's also a sweet lightness to being, that which is promising. To live only once means to live only for one. Some human beings eventually reach this point in their lives, a moment in time where they realize that life is theirs for the taking, and because it is only theirs momentarily, they may choose to live as they please, allowing no grievance to take that sweetness away. The main characters of Milan Kundera's The Unbearable Lightness of Being spend their lives searching for and abandoning love, sex, and the purpose of life in an attempt to find themselves within the meaning of their actions and the actions of those around them. Tomas is conflicted with feelings of love and desire. He craves to uncover the significance of his feelings and of his life in general, by means of his relationships and his career and lifestyle choices. She was neither mistress nor wife. She was a child whom he had taken from a bulrush basket that had been daubed with pitch and sent to the riverbank of his bed, stated Milan Kundera when discussing the relationship between Tomas and his wife Teresa from the perspective of Tomas. Tomas considered Teresa a child at heart, a child who needed rescuing. So time and time again, he would rescue her from her childhood, rescue her from her profession, rescue her from herself, and most importantly, rescue her from Tomas himself. Teresa represented the part of himself that he desperately wanted to abandon. From the moment he met her, he contemplated allowing her into his life, for he knew that she could not simply blend into the array of women he had made his in his flat. She was a child who needed to be cared for, and in part, he was a man prepared to care for her. But also, in part, he was a boy bent on pursuing his sexual liberties, and he would allow no room for distraction. Teresa, however, never fit in tune with his experiments. for what she sparked within his being was something he had never before encountered. Through her, he found love. He loved Teresa so much that he hated her simultaneously. Teresa was Tomas's weakness. He married her simply in an attempt to satisfy her craving for monogamy, but in truth, he spent the greater amount of his life detesting his need of her. He longed for the days when he simply slept with women and had no concern other than his own satisfaction. Tomas's obsession was not with sex nor with his mistress, Sabina. It was with the part of a woman that makes her unique from the rest of the women in the world. He wanted to dissect his mistress, like he wanted to dissect all of the women he had ever been with, all except for Teresa. He wanted to explore the world unknown to him and unknown to all of humanity. The world fostered only within the bodies of the women with which he had sexual encounters. He was in love with Teresa, so while he craved her physically, he also wanted to possess her emotionally. He had always needed women, but he had never wanted to sleep with a woman in the conventional sense of the word until he met Teresa. Her presence and his inability to abandon her meant one thing and one thing only. He would live for Teresa. His pointless existence would be all the more minimized to existing for Teresa, not even for himself. No matter the circumstances, Teresa was the most important part of the mess. She was his home, his comfort, his life, and he detested her for it, until he was given the opportunity to appreciate the beauty behind their relationship, that which extended beyond his infidelities and her insecurities, that which was raw and genuine, that which was love. In life, it is far too easy to fall victim to one's experiences. Our past should encourage us to persevere, to change for the better, yet they prevent us from continuing on. We are afraid to fall prey to another human being through love. But love is not to be feared, it is to be embraced. To be overcome by passion for another person is not only one of the strongest emotions to be felt, but it is also one of the most fulfilling emotions one may encounter. We live day by day, pushing ourselves to the brink in order to fulfill our aspirations. But whom are we living for? Most would say, we are living for our families. Thus, we are living for love. So how is it that we may allow ourselves to love those who brought us into this world, those who we consider family, even if we are not all related by blood, but due to our personal experiences or the experiences of those around us, we refuse to allow passion into our hearts. There will always be an obstacle to overcome, a past relationship that has made us fearful of love, but we must embrace our fears so that we may be truly content. The company of many pales in comparison to the company of the one you love. But this is a truth one must discover for themselves. For if you are not willing to fight the battles created within yourself by your past for the future ahead, you may only ever know a shade of the life you were destined to lead. She wanted to love, but she could not. Teresa wanted to trust, but she could not. And above all else, she wanted to live, but she could not. Teresa could not live in the present because she was at constant war with her past. She sat transfixed on the edge of the bath, unable to take her eyes off the dying crow. In its solitude and desolation, she saw a reflection of her own fate, and she repeated several times to herself, I have no one left in the world but the mess. Teresa longed for a life of fulfillment. Fulfillment in the aspects of life that mattered most. Love, fidelity, and strength. Like Tomas, Teresa too was at constant war. War with her mother, for she was dealing with the unresolved issues of the past created by her mother's own personal conflictions. War with Tomas for his inability to be faithful, to be content with Teresa and only Teresa. And war with herself for being too weak to withstand the haunting memory of Tomas's of her mother and for being too weak to ignore Tomas's infidelities. She would always love Tomas, but she would no longer hold him hostage. She wanted him to be free, free to pursue every desire that composed his very being. And she too would be free, free to indulge in happiness, for she had never really been happy before. She longed to understand Tomas. And at the same time, she wanted to free herself. Her intention was to discover the joy that was lost while making love with Tomas by allowing her body to have sex with other men like the mass allowed his body to have sex with other women. Instead, she fought every second of it, fought to not allow her soul to cheat on Tomas, fought to not allow her mind to participate in the act, and fought to not allow her body to take pleasure in the motion of a stranger's body stroking hers. Teresa could not fill the void created by Tomas's need for rendezvous with other women. She could not escape Tomas's infidelities, not even in her dreams. He haunted her. He was her angel who had rescued her from her meaningless life, and her demon that haunted her in her sleep. Teresa lay powerless to the will imposed on her by Tomas. She too was trapped in her relationship, but unlike Tomas, she was not trapped in the sense that she wanted to run away, but could not allow herself to do so. She was trapped in the sense that she wanted to propel forward into her relationship, but she refused to allow herself to do so. Teresa was so raveled in her insecurities that she blamed herself for Tomas's love of her, as if it had been her weaknesses that made her impossible to neglect. Teresa blamed herself for all of Tomas's misfortunes. She took full responsibility for his importunities, for she believed that she was the root of all of his problems. Teresa's insecurity were the only real piece of herself she possessed. She searched long for meaning to her life, but she wasn't able to find anything beyond the hate she possessed for herself and her shortcomings. They blinded her from seeing that Tomas did indeed love her for her kind heart, her humble past, and her beliefs. Yes, he needed to rescue her, but only from herself, for her insecurities were the biggest obstacle standing in the way of her finding peace and purpose within peace. Sometimes being deceived and mistreated leads one to become guarded and mistrusting. Other times, one winds up repeating the mistakes of the past, by allowing oneself to be disrespected time and time again, for due to all of the damage one has withstood, one is deceived into the mentality that one deserves to be treated poorly. For it is one's own fault that life has become a repetition of painful encounters and toxic relationships. This mentality derives from the insecurities one is ambushed with after experiencing the mental and physical abuse of unhealthy relationships. One cannot become a prisoner within one's own mind. In order to break free, however, one must abandon all fear and all feelings of unworthiness and embrace the possibility that there is more to life than living underneath the shadows of those in our past who have torn us down. To build yourself up again, you must become the exception. To regain one's strength may be one of the most difficult challenges many will ever face. But the gratification one will be overcome with by the end of this journey will make all of the sacrifice worthwhile. One cannot allow oneself to be lost in the rapture of fear. One must fight to live, fight to discover purpose for persevering. That purpose being that by helping oneself, one will grow wiser and one will grow stronger. And in light of these newfound qualities, one will apply such knowledge to help others who have lost themselves to self-doubt. Thus, one will be saving others from a meaningless life while applying meaning to one's own life. Sabina, like Tomas, was devoted to a life of lightness, but it was this life that ended up betraying her, for due to her choices, she wound up alone, with no one left to love when she was finally done abandoning the people in her life. She was well aware it was an illusion. Her days with the aging couple were merely a brief interval. Sabina's path of betrayals would then continue elsewhere, and from the depths of her being, a silly, mawkish song about two shining windows and a happy family living behind them would occasionally make its way into the unbearable lightness of being. Sabina represents all components of lightness. From her yearning for avoiding any form of seriousness in her relationships, to her hate of all things profound. She fought her emotions with every ounce of strength she possessed, and when she could fight no longer, she would abandon her life as she knew it to continue on in her path of deceit. Sabina valued her privacy. She detested the thought of being dissected by the public eye's microscope, and she refused to live her days accounting for others' opinions of her personal decisions. For this reason, she ended her relationship with the love of her life, Franz. She wanted to live her life only as she had designed it. When Franz admitted to his wife, Marie Claude, that he was in love with his mistress, Sabina, she could not help but want to run away from the predicament in which she found herself. She and Franz were very different, and this bothered Sabina for a long time, but there was never a difference as great as this one. For in the eyes of Franz, he was finally recognizing Sabina as the woman he wanted to spend the remainder of his life with. But for Sabina, he was declaring the end to their relationship. Sabina did not belong to Gamas. She did not belong to Franz. Sabina did not belong to anyone or anything because she deemed herself unfit to belong, for she deemed herself unfit to be loved. She lived to abandon her many lives, to abandon her many souls, to abandon all forms of heaviness. In every new scenario, no matter how blissful, she found a reason to be dissatisfied. She had no home because she would allow no restrictions to be placed on her existence. For this reason, she found the freedom she desired in America. She was free from the kitsch lifestyle and the obstacles of her former life. Sabina had abandoned every significant relationship she had ever had, for she viewed love as another restriction. But after abandoning all whom she ever held dear, she could not help but wonder whether she had anything left to live for at all, and whether she was mistaken in believing that a heavy yet meaningful life was worse than a light, meaningless one. To live a free life or to live a significant one is a question that begs to be answered. In freedom, one is light. Light enough to have the ability to float away from reality, viewing the world around one as a mere picture, taking in the scenery, but never actually becoming engrossed within the photograph itself. In living significantly, we run the risk of being crushed, crushed by responsibility, crushed by emotions, crushed by the truth of existence. Yet it is the most real form of life one may encounter. To lead a burdened or burdenless life, only one can answer this for themselves. It is often the most noble of people who are abused and mistreated by those shameless enough to take advantage of genuine kindness. This was the case for Franz. At that point, the girl with glasses vanished from his thoughts, and Sabina fixed her eyes on him. Unreal Sabina, with her grand fate, Sabina who had made him feel so small. Her wrathful eyes bored into him, angry and dissatisfied. Had he been had once again? Had someone else abused his idiotic goodness? Franz lived to find meaning and purpose behind every encounter, every action, and every event he faced. When faced with death, Franz had an epiphany. He came to the realization that his mistress, Sabina, represented everything in his life that he wished he could change. She was a free spirit, an experiment with immeasurable results. He was a meticulously thought out and well executed plan. He envied her ability to ignore all that displeased her and her ability to abandon anything and anyone who no longer served a purpose in her life. Franz, unlike Sabina, cared deeply about the world around him. He could not bring himself to abandon his wife, not because he wanted to be with her, but because he could not put her through the pain and suffering his father had put his mother through during his childhood. He could not break her heart by admitting that he no longer loved her, so he stayed with her for years, and in those years, he satisfied his own sexual desires with his mistress. Unbeknownst to him, however, was the truth that lay behind his secret relationship. For while he was living a lie with his mistress was living a truth through him. Until the events that led Franz to his death occurred, he was blinded by his need to live a truthful, noble life. Even after separating from his wife and being left to sulk in his lonesome misery by Sabina, he could not find the purpose behind his current situation. Upon meeting the girl with the glasses, a student of his who he fell in love with, he still managed to compare her to Sabina. He did not love Sabina, he only thought that he did. Yes, he wanted to be her male correspondent, but he eventually realized that his relationship with her was built on a web of lies, and his relationship with his student was the only truth he had ever really known. As human beings, we tend to be attracted to people who are unlike us, for the characteristics they possess are appealing. Their actions and thought processes are a mystery to the lives we lead. Oftentimes, however, these partners are poisonous to one. Because they do not share in our beliefs, they force us to act differently than we are accustomed to. One cannot fall victim to one's desires. We must not allow our vision to be fogged by others' auras and ways of life, for as intriguing as they might be, that does not necessarily mean they will suit us as adequately. We cannot force ourselves to find truth in others if we cannot first find truth within ourselves. To know oneself is one of the most difficult challenges one will face in life. But once you have overcome the fear in projecting your truth to the world, you will be able to stop looking for the personality you are attracted to and start looking for the person who complements your own being. The unbearable lightness of being presents many lessons regarding relationships, life, and the power they can possess over one if permitted. Weight versus lightness is the binding battle joining Thomas, Teresa, Sabina, and Franz. Weight being the burdens that aid us in attaining the most out of life, and lightness being the separation of meaning that is sometimes required to live tranquilly. In truth, there is no correct answer, for there is no correct way to lead one's life in weight or in lightness. You cannot disregard your own feelings to satisfy others' expectations. You cannot limit yourself or the love you foster out of fear. You cannot run away from the people most important to you due to feelings of unworthiness. You can, however, live for yourself as equally as you live for the people in your life. You can accept that not all people will treat you kindly, but that does not mean that you should not continue to share your love with the world. For as there are lost souls out there, there are also genuine souls to be unearthed. You can overcome your insecurities by embracing the lessons that you have gained through them in your lifetime thus far, and use the remainder of your days to pursue all that you have ever abandoned out of fear. In turn, you can encourage others who are suffering like you once were to discover meaning within the tragedies they may be facing. A wise professor once told me that dark literature could be used in one of two ways. It could either inflict feelings of unworthiness and depression upon the reader, or it could fill the reader with motivation and purpose. It simply depends on the way in which one interprets the knowledge they have gained. It is often difficult to learn from someone else's mistakes, but it is easy to find mistakes one has committed which relate to that of a character within a piece of literature. One must take what they have learned and apply it in a positive manner to their own life. To become a victim of a piece of literature is easy, but to transform that piece of literature so that it may reflect a deeper meaning than what is revealed on the surface is not. However, it is the more rewarding of the two paths. For if one seeks to find purpose within all that is presented to them, they will not allow themselves to be torn down by their experiences, nor will they seek to tear others down. They will apply their knowledge to their lives and the lives of those around them in a positive manner in order to aid and encourage others, in turn growing and prospering as individuals. You can uncover the truth behind your faults and discover that life will be awaiting you on the other side, prepared to embrace you and all that defines you. All you have to be is willing. Thank you. And now I would like to invite my fellow Sigma Kappa Delta members, Cindy, so that she and I may answer any questions that you may have or respond to any commentary. And we are requesting interaction, so if anyone in the audience would like to answer questions as well, you're more than welcome to. There will be a microphone going around.
I'll start. Do you think Kundera is indicating that we have to make mistakes to find wisdom? Do we have to fall down, get beat up, get scars, find wisdom? Or is it wisdom through literatures and philosophies and wise loved ones or friends that allows us to circumvent or get around mistakes? In other words, if we're equipped with the wisdom, can we avoid those tragedies? Or do those tragedies give us the ability to gain wisdom and then, through our loss, make changes for the better? What do you think he's indicating about that?
I think it's both. I think that as equally as you may learn from a piece of literature lessons that perhaps, you know, before were unknown to you, You can also learn them from experience, and you can also learn them from the experiences of others. Sometimes even avoiding making those mistakes will force you to learn other lessons through other errors that may occur in the process. But in reality, it's both. Sometimes you can learn from others, sometimes you can't. There are certain things that, regardless of the circumstances, you need to learn on your own in order for it to truly resonate. Other times, when you witness the pain and agony that others may go through in the process of certain errors in judgment or lapses in judgment, you will learn from that, because it's more than likely that it's someone dear to your heart, so you will feel pain through their pain. But regardless, it requires both. It just depends on the circumstance. Would anyone in the audience care to answer that question presented by Professor Rodriguez, or any comment? Does anyone else have a different question that they would like to ask? Yeah, of course, please.
I think it's mostly based on the person, possibly. Sure, some of them go through some difficult times, which kind of like builds a person up, but it also can break a person down physically and mentally. So, also, it breaks a person down physically and mentally to where a point where they can't really go on. So it also has to possibly be a strong, will-minded person to be able to be put through those kind of difficult tasks along the go with life. Because if not, then you can't really move forward. Because I know a lot of people that have gone through a lot of really bad and horrible accidents and things. Some people either give up and they really don't see any reason for moving forward. But I've also seen some other people that have gone through like above and beyond and a lot better than they thought they would have ended up. For myself, how I see myself, like, to tell you the truth, I really shouldn't be alive at this point. I was in a really bad car accident when I was a child. And to see myself now from like 5 years ago to 21, I see myself as being above and beyond that, what I thought what was unreachable. So actually almost graduating from here with an associate's degree in anthropology, and what I'm working on beyond and farther beyond that to achieve what I really want to. So I think it kind of dwells on, yes, you do have to go through some tough things in order to prepare for life, and sometimes you just really gotta build up yourself besides that, if that answers this question.
Thank you for that. No, I absolutely agree. There are exceptions and you are one, and we appreciate you sharing that with us. It's certainly something to be proud of, all that you've accomplished thus far. So thank you. Would anyone else like to answer or ask a question? Or comment or anything? And it can be related to the novel, to my speech. It can be a comment just in general, a motivational comment, whatever it may be. Anything that you would like to share with the audience is more than welcome.
First of all, that was quite an impressive paper, I just want to say, as a fellow colleague of Professor Rodriguez, English teacher here. So what I was wondering about is the whole idea presented here of relationships, and how relationships can comfort and they can also destroy.
Exactly.
Especially when there's deceitfulness, when there's commitments that have been broken. So I guess the question is what do you think makes the human being yearn for something that they cannot have or not see in what they do have? More specifically, Tomas had a wife, and he wasn't fulfilled by it. So he had a mistress, and the mistress wasn't fulfilled by that relationship, so she had another lover, and it kind of got very much into a web. So then you wonder about fidelity, and what makes people not be able to find satisfaction in the relationships they have? Is it that they just don't work toward it, Or is there something more? Is it sexual?
Well, first, would anyone in the audience like to answer? Anyone? I think it's a little bit of both. I think that as human beings, the way at least our generation has been raised, we always want more. We're always seeking more. We're never satisfied entirely with what we have, no matter how grand. So even relationships and even love, we're always seeking to find more. We're always seeking to fill this void, this null, this satisfaction that yearns to be filled. And truly, we can never discover that in our lifetime until we can first become content with ourselves as individuals, as beings, before we can find that there is more to life than seeking multiple relationships and multiple sexual partners. It goes beyond that to the emotional attachment and just the genuine connection. It goes beyond trust issues and, you know, all of the problems that we as human beings deal with on a regular basis. You know, it's when you connect with someone on a level that you had never even contemplated, that you had never even thought possible, when you realize that, you know, all of that yearning and all of that longing that you've been searching for can be satisfied if you give it the opportunity to do so.
I just want to add to that is I think communication between within relationships is also a huge part of it. If someone is not satisfying your needs and you don't communicate that and you don't work through it, then you tend to want to look elsewhere. So I think that, and I wanted to say that in all kinds of relationships, but particularly in intimate relationships and in sexual relationships, that there has to be a communication beyond just the body, you know, to maintain it. And if you're in trouble, you know, sometimes you need help from the outside.
I agree. I certainly don't beg to differ with that. But yes, again, communication, like you said, would be a huge factor to overcome in a relationship in order to find that satisfaction of being only with that one individual versus seeking other partners, emotional or physical.
That's why we don't want you sitting so far back.
I know, seriously. What I wanted to add in is that in a relationship, we cannot not communicate. And like, ultimately, we need to talk with one another. It's a transaction, we need to. And I feel as though that in this generation, communication has been like increasing with technology, but at the same time, it's also been decreasing. And how we communicate with each other. Nowadays we text and we just say, oh, hey, and like half a hey, like H-Y or something like that. Not even the full hey. It's like halfway. So I feel like as though relationships need to kind of stay away from that social media and also from technology and actually kind of appreciate communication. Because sometimes like I text, and like with the one day, and like I honestly hate it. I prefer talking on the phone because I feel like it's more of a real connection. So in relationships, I believe communication is really key. So
I agree. Would anyone else like to comment on that? Of course.
I agree with what he's saying. I used to be I had a relationship a while back. For some reason, she always got really nervous and really tense with me. And I even told her, like, I don't like that. Don't do that with me, please. But the more she did it, the more it just upset me about it. So like one night, she just decided to dump me over text message, which kind of sucked. And so I'm like, all right, I'm fine with it. But what kind of like really I didn't like is it disrespected me. I would have rather had her do it face-to-face with me instead of doing it over a text message. Because it's not, that's like a wall, it's not really showing communication. between one person and another. It's like completely cutting you off. So I'd rather be more social than being on a device that really blocks another person from another. You really don't know what the person's telling you. You really don't feel any emotional connection with anybody else. So that's kind of like really, it cuts the person off just right there and then. It doesn't really work.
I agree. I mean, if we're focusing in the perspective of relationships in our day and age versus the mid, 1960s and 1970s, it is certainly easier to run away not only from relationships, but from problems in general via technology, because like you said, it's an easier form of avoidance amongst other things, you know? I feel like it's not only easy to say no to certain things or run away from certain problems or end certain relationships, but also agree to certain things that more than likely in person you wouldn't normally agree to or you wouldn't normally agree to commit, you know? So there's certainly that back and forth between whether it has been a blessing for our generation to, you know, have this advancement in technology or a burden, but I agree. Does anyone else have any commentary or any questions or anything that they would like to add? We're encouraging interaction, you guys. It's okay, you don't have to be shy. If you have anything that you want to say, please do.
Can I have a comment?
Sure.
I would argue that the mic's not turned on very well in the text. You need to try this mic.
Can you try this mic here?
No, not that one. The other one.
I'm sorry. I didn't realize that.
I better work
on how to turn this on.
Is it not on? Speak into a push button in the back and forth.
I don't know. Is it on? No.
Is that on?
Is it on? I have to talk like right here. Okay. So I would argue that technology is a burden, because back in the day, you know, you went through childhood, you passed through things that were traumatizing, which would influence the person you become in the relationships. And now I've noticed there's people like on Instagram, for example, something you can all relate to. There's people that have like 1,000, 2,000 followers and they're like all savvy on there. But you see them in person and there's a person sitting in the corner, not really socializing. So I feel like technology now acts as another identity of a person. Would anyone want to comment on that or question?
I think that I saw a question in the back. I'm not sure if you're still, okay.
Well, it's not a comment on her comment. It's on something previous that Blaine in the front said. On page 3, I noticed you mentioned that we are afraid to fall prey to another human being through love. And I think that one of the reasons this book portrays so many relationships, emotional and sexual relationships, is because falling prey to love is you being vulnerable with another person. So I think in a way we seek relationships, not just in monogamy with one person, but with multiple people, as a way to not let ourselves be too vulnerable with one person. So do you think that could be one of the reasons, not just because of satisfaction, you're not set up sexually or emotionally satisfied, but because you're afraid to be vulnerable and be, let yourself be hurt by this person?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, not to lessen your comment by any means, but it is kind of that rebound mentality. You know, when you have multiple people that you're with or multiple options, losing one doesn't necessarily affect you as, you know, crucially as it might have had that been your only person, your only love, your only being that you had that emotional attachment with. So absolutely, I agree. I mean, you know, many people are not necessarily in open relationships, but perhaps cheat amongst other things for that reason, you know, because they don't want to be emotionally vulnerable. And they don't want to allow themselves, you know, to fall into the possibility of being hurt or damaged any further than they might have been already. So, I agree.
What I wanted to add on to what you just said, that is true. Sometimes we see multiple partners because we really don't want to be hurt at the end. And what I wanted to also include that ultimately you have to love yourself at the end. You have to love yourself. And if you don't love yourself, you're just going to be seeking multiple people to kind of just distract your inner self-love with others. And like, I feel when you find that one partner that appreciates you and also you appreciate them and you guys kind of love one another, like, I think that's true love right there, honestly. And yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to comment anything or ask a question?
I feel like in having a lot of partners, yeah, you're trying not to get hurt, but the people that you're hurting are the partners that you're with. Because, I mean, look at Teresa, like, she felt like she was the reason that that he was doing all this, and she was taking responsibility, and it wasn't even her fault. Like, she, like, all she did was love him. So I feel like he's being selfish in what he's doing to her. Even though he says that he loves her, but does he really love her if he's doing all this stuff to her?
Absolutely, I agree. I think that we don't consider other people's feelings, like Thomas didn't consider Teresa's feelings to the extent that he should have. In part, he felt as if he was doing nothing wrong. He felt like because there was no connection in his mentality between sex and love, the woman that he wanted to sleep with had nothing to do with the women that he wanted to have sex with. There was no correlation in his mind. So to him, he was doing nothing wrong. But in general, you know, especially from per se our mentalities, absolutely, the damage that he caused her and the pain and suffering that she experienced, it's unfathomable. You know, it tore her down and she felt as if she had become nothing. She existed only for him because she was unworthy of anyone else. And that was because of all the pain and all the suffering that he inflicted upon her. So I agree.
Okay, just kind of bear with me because I'm kind of all over the place with everything, but...
Get out here, dude. Can you speak to the mic?
Kind of bear with me here because I'm going all over the place with relationships and mistakes and all that. Going back to Mr. Rodriguez. So the saying, what doesn't kill us makes us stronger. I believe we need to make mistakes because every day we're constantly learning and growing, so in order to learn and grow, we have to make those mistakes. Just personally from my own experiences. But as far as being the victim of whatever situation you're in, people make that choice. They have options, they have these choices with whether it's bad or wrong, they have to suffer those consequences, whether it's good or bad. For instance, for the people who have an issue, or just say, for like my parents, if they got divorced and I'm going through that, I could be advisable to other people who are going through that same situation, but in my case, where am I seeking my help? I'm the victim of going through it. So I can help other people, but for me, I have to be more resourceful to other people who are going through the same thing. Like, I'm trying to go through the story with let's talk about relationships, but that's their problem where he's going off with mistresses. But I'm trying to relate my problem. Like, how can I be, I'm being advice of other people, but where am I thinking my own? Like, in the story, where is he finding?
I understand. I mean, I think that for your personal scenario, it's more difficult, you know, to find peace and to accept the circumstances, you know, under your parents' relationship, only because you're not, you know, directly at peace with that relationship. You're not your mother, or as equally as you are not your father. Therefore, the choices that they make, while they completely, entirely concern you and affect you, you cannot control them, or, you know.
Yeah, that's what I meant. So things that are out of my control.
I think that, just like with anything else, and this can reflect directly within my personal essay, it's just about finding peace within yourself before you can even come to terms with accepting the losses or things, you know, of that nature that you are experiencing through others in your life, through your loved ones, or in your case, your parents. The thing is, I feel like with, you know, scenarios like that, there isn't an on and off switch. You can't, you know, become content with your life and accept what's occurred to you just, you know, just based off of your own free will. But that is the first step, you know, being prepared to take on life's challenges, including, you know, whatever issues your parents may foster within their relationship, and not allowing that to affect you in the long run, excuse me, and affect your relationships in the future. But, I mean, because I'm not dealing with a relationship or with that.
Well, it's just with, relationship, the whole social media stuff. Everything is just out of everyone else's control. You can't really control that. So I just want to say it depends on the person. Everyone has their own option. I mean, you have a choice whether you're communicating with somebody and you want to send through the text, or you want to be in an intimate way. Everyone's different and they show it differently. So back to the story, I guess he showed it by going and instead of communicating, he went and did other things because he was just curious.
Thank you.
I just want to add something. I feel in your situation that happened is when you help others, you kind of help yourself in a way. Like, you find your own strength when you help others. That's how I feel in that scenario. Because when you go into the situation, you know, how do I help myself, you know? I think in the process, you will find that strength.
One more question.
First of all, Denise, did you write this?
Yeah.
Oh my God, I'm so impressed.
Thank you.
What do you charge to write the papers that are due?
$50.
I'm all out of it. It's a great paper, but
I appreciate it. Thank you.
I've been married for 25 years, and I think with a lot of relationships, it's about boredom. You get bored, you get stuck in the same routine over and over, and I think you just need to liven it up every now and then to help relationships. This guy, I think he's bored. He obviously hasn't found himself and knows who he is, so, so that's what I wanted to say.
No, I agree. It's absolutely a battle with identity. I mean, you know, we're told this time and time again, and we refuse to live by it, but until you discover who you are as an individual, it's impossible for you to find satisfaction within someone else and within a relationship with someone else. You'll always be yearning for something more until you're content with your life. And then, at that point, you can be content with a life being shared with another individual. I think I saw a hand in the back, I'm not sure. Or Professor Rodriguez as well.
I just want to say, to me, the most important key to relationship, even to all kinds of communication, I think the most important thing is you have to know who you are. A lot of times we don't know who we are, we get lost. So we, you know, try to find love, I call it quick love, you know, get into relationship, you meet, have sex. then you kind of realize, this is not what I want. So you jump into another relationship. To the end, you kind of like, who am I? So you kind of like, you know, keep asking yourself again and again. Myself, I came from China. I had no family, no friends when first time I came here. So I got married here, and a year after I had a kid. Then a few years later, for like 6 or 7 years, I don't know who I am. I was in a relationship. I was married, you know. I was a mom. I was all kinds of, but I was not happy with my relationship. So then I decided to leave the relationship. Then after that divorce, it was really hard for me, you know, financially, emotionally. But you know, I think what I did was every day I tell myself, be strong and tell yourself how beautiful you are and how handsome you are. It's a practice. If you do it every day, if you do it often, this inner confidence, you know, kind of like, you know, outshine, you know, through you, and you just feel more content with yourself. And there are times I'm very busy, but I write journals, write down the feelings, you know, what do you feel today, you know, what happened today. You don't have to write any single details. You write it down, you know, what's significant to you. So you kind of, you know, every day, you know, you kind of get to know who you are. You have to love yourself. Yeah, I love myself. For me to be a great mom, I have to be happy and love myself first.
I absolutely agree. It's, you know, you have to be content with yourself. And I mean, it's a beautiful feeling, you know, the satisfaction that you receive once you've reached that point in your life. And it's a process and it will continue, you know, for years to come. But what's important is that, you know, you're fighting that battle within yourself and you're being strong throughout it. And you should be proud. Thank you. Would anyone else like to comment or? Oh, okay. Did you
want to? Just real quick.
Yeah, of course.
We've been doing these events for several years now, and I think Shelly will agree. For at least the last 5 or 6 years, the discussion post panel, it invariably turns to social media or Twitter or texting. Something of that nature invariably goes back to that. Moreover, the overall sensation, I would say, is one of dissatisfaction. What I'll tell you, just because it's surfacing again in relation to loving yourself and knowing yourself. I've said it before, and I try and begin with myself, so I fail here too. You have to believe that you are an agent of change. If you don't like the way we're communicating, I wouldn't learn technology. I would start with myself. Technology's not going away. We're not going back to the abacus, right? So we have to figure out a way to take our current apparatus, make it authentic, and make it fulfilling. I don't have an answer up here, but I want to leave you with that. That if you don't like the way thing is going, communication or technology or education or whatever it is, if you don't like it, well, begin 10 minutes ago, changing it. Write about it. What am I going to do tomorrow? I'll leave those doors to start changing things. And I can tell you, if you don't, my generation is here now and will be gone before you know it. And we're one of the last links, if you will, to that more organic lifestyle. Take advantage of us. Talk to us. And, figure out how we communicated a bit more effectively, if we did, in years past. And I've talked to the previous generation, so on and so forth. You can reverse it. You guys sit down, think about it, get a purpose, get a plan, and put it into effect. If you don't, one day goes to the next, and before you know it, you're grunting for communication. But you can change this. You can save it. You can have a great relationship as a result. It always comes back to that. You're in, you're out. I think we're about done. You want to say anything else, Denise, to close up?
I just wanted to thank you all for coming. I did want to say, you know, my intent was certainly not to create, you know, any form of a negative atmosphere. I just wanted to hopefully encourage you all to reflect upon relationships in your life and, you know, characteristics and traits that you may find within yourself that you are dissatisfied with and that you can attempt to improve and change about yourself eventually, if ever. But aside from that, I just wanted to thank you all for coming, regardless of the reasoning. And I wanted to encourage you all to join us in the student lounge. We'll be offering refreshments, coffee and cookies, if you'd like, complimentary, of course. And, well, again, I just want to thank you all for coming out. We really appreciate it. On behalf of myself and my fellow Sigma Kappa Delta members. Cindy, would you like to say anything? Cindy, we'll take the mic.
Well, I would just like to say thank you for coming, and I encourage you guys to read the novel. It was very interesting, and well, I wouldn't have read it if it wasn't for joining Sigma Kappa Delta. So yeah, thank you.